Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 9. You can find us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and you can also find all those links on theseedsofliberty.com. So today we have Jon Moss coming from Connecticut. He has a Facebook page, The New Sons and Daughters of Liberty, and he's also an admin on Raising Common Sense Anarchists. And he is an anarchist slash unschooling father of a 7-year-old, practicing the radical method of unschooling, churning out kids anti-state style. Nice. So, Jon, tell us a little bit. Why don't we start with how you became an anarchist, and then we'll dive into the unschooling philosophy.
All right. Well, thanks for having me on, guys. I appreciate it.
Thank you for your service.
Right.
Yes.
I call every homeschooler, you know, that's thank you for your service.
We're actually providing a legit service. We're actually cranking out anti-state kids. So, my path to anarchy is pretty similar to just about anybody's. There's really nothing special about it. It's your typical, you know, used to be a constitutionalist, used to be a neocon, and got sick of that and thought I was a liberal for a while and realized they're just as bad and became a big L libertarian for a while, was still into voting and thought that mattered, and got into Ron Paul, Gary Johnson, and the natural progression of things was that it didn't stop for me. It was like, well, this a little bit of freedom sounds nice, well, what about more freedom? And ultimately that just leads you to the logical conclusion of a stateless society, and here I am.
You didn't vote for Obama, did you?
No.
Dave's never going to let me live it down.
I would have probably had to dip out.
We can't really forget it. You announced it during at least the first 3 episodes.
That was our moment of, like, you know, confessions. It's like the confessional here.
Oh, just
for our past sins. Political sins.
When I say I thought I was a liberal, I was a liberal in the sense of, like, well, conservatives are stupid, so I must be a liberal, you know, like that thing. But the only time I ever voted in a presidential election was 2008 and 2012. And 2008, I voted for Bob Barr. In 2012, I voted Gary Johnson. Both guys were a Libertarian Party, so I didn't know what I was doing. But I was like, well, these two assholes suck, so I'll vote the Libertarian. That was good.
I voted for myself in the 2008 election. I wrote my name in as president.
Excellent.
I don't know if I've told you guys this. I couldn't vote for McCain.
Oh yeah.
Because he was such a liberal flip flopper. Like.
Yeah, he looks old and creepy.
So his age had nothing to do with it. Ron Paul was not going to win it. So.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So Jon, what personalities influenced your path to unschooling, or you know, people or books or podcasts?
This is a good one. I've always been a big fan of talk radio. So when I was younger, I started getting into it. You guys ever heard of Michael Savage? Savage Nation.
Yes. Yeah. You guys the Jew that hates Jews. Yes.
Yeah. Right. The guy's a fucking lunatic, but that's who I started listening to.
He is a lunatic, Jesus almighty.
He's a lunatic, but he was entertaining, so he got me to listen because I thought he was entertaining. Actually, what had happened was I was working for a radio station at the time. Nothing glamorous, just like some weekend board work. And while I was there, one of the shows that came on that I syndicated was Michael Savage, so I had no choice but to sit and listen to him. And I'm listening to him rag on Obama and call out all of his all the scandals and all that, and I'm like, this guy's got a point. And it just kind of sucked you into that whole borders, language, culture nonsense. So I was really big into that for a while, being a real neocon. And a little after that, I discovered Alex Jones and got into that whole nightmare for a while and was listening to InfoWars all the time.
Fear everything, boys!
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, listening to that long enough, you're ready to go fucking live in a bunker for the next 10 years. So yeah. While listening to Alex Jones and getting into the whole conspiracy theory thing, it actually did get me to see what bullshit the state is. But I had fundamentally disagreed with Alex Jones, because we're both sitting here going, oh my God, the government blew up 9/11, blah, 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 blah. he wants to restore the Republic. I say, well, if they're that fucking evil, let's just get rid of them entirely. I don't want to restore the Republic. So I had disagreed on that and eventually discovered Adam Kokesh and started listening to Adam versus the Man, which was an awesome show, and I dropped InfoWars entirely because InfoWars made me nothing but scared and angry, and Adam Kokesh was funny. He was funny, he was upbeat, and he was more like, I love you, bro. Like, you know, he was just so lighthearted. And he was talking about voluntarism and all of that stuff, so I really got into him. And then discovered Chris Cantwell and discovered Larkin Rose and Stefan Molyneux and all these other guys, and here I am today.
Yeah, I was mainly influenced when my son was born. My wife, like a year later, she showed me a video by Stefan Molyneux on spanking and corporal punishment, and that's basically my first introduction to Stefan Molyneux. So, and that's how I went down the path of voluntarism through that. And yeah, he's an awesome force for peaceful parenting and you know, homeschooling. I really appreciate what he's doing, his work.
I think I got it screwed up from before. I when you asked me my path, I was liberal first, then went to neocon, and then just realized that. So correction, that's
mm-hmm. Well, I think the step from being a liberal to being a neocon is a bigger step than becoming a minarchist to a voluntarist.
No, because, not really.
You know, like, well, yeah,
they're a lot more,
it depends on your family, really.
They're a lot more similar than they like to believe. That's why they stay at each other's throats all the time, because they've been convinced that they're the exact opposite, even though they're really fighting for the they're fighting for the same things. They just give them different names, and they point the finger and say, now go after that guy, and they all go, okay.
Yeah, it's like walking up on two brothers fighting, and then like you hit one of the brothers, and then they both look at you like, you can't hit my brother. And they jump on you. You're like, they're arguing about same-sex marriage, and you're like, I don't actually think the state should exist. And they're like, the what? Get him!
Yeah, I was going to say, it's funny you mentioned the Michael Savage thing, because I've seen that a lot, actually, that when you go through that stage, there's usually one of those maniacs that you find, and then that's the one that starts leading you. For me, it was Mark Levin. He's a nut job. He screams and calls everybody statist, and now I just look at him and go, you don't know what that word means, do you?
Yeah, I had one in his book. It was called Freedom to Fascism or something like that. I can't remember.
That's the movie.
No. He has a book called something about fascism.
Oh, I should know. I have every one of them on my bookshelf. One of them signed. I actually met him.
Yeah,
I gave up statism altogether.
The whole book, he's talking about statists. Statists want this, statists want that. And then, like, anybody that asks him, should anarchy be is anarchy even plausible? He's like, no, that anybody that's an anarchist is an idiot. And like, well, you do know that the opposite of anarchy is statism. Mm-hmm. This is not a gray. There's no black and white. Like, you can't be a minarchist and hate statist. You are a statist. You're a self-loathing statist.
I remember when libertarian was the big buzzword, and everyone was like, you're a libertarian? Oh, so you support Ted Cruz and Rand Paul? Like, no, no, fucking support Ted Cruz.
No, he's a neocon warhawk.
Well, that's part of how the language gets co-opted, and how the state, you know, helps perpetuate itself by convincing people that the language changes. And that's why, you know, that's why there's now the distinction between classical liberal and today's liberal, because they hijack words, and it happens on all sides of the status paradigm. And status is just the latest one, because they're gonna, you know, the ones that have the most invested in convincing their base that they're the ones that want real freedom, they'll cling to these words as quickly as they can and try to make it seem like they're the ones fighting for
maybe
freedom.
Maybe Mark Levin is a voluntarist, but just can't admit it.
No, not by a long shot. He deifies the founding fathers.
No, but if he came out on one episode and was like, hey guys, everything I've been saying for the last 10 years is complete bullshit. Anarchy's the way to go. And by the way, if you're a neocon, you're an idiot. Like, yeah. he's gonna go bankrupt. Well, he's gonna lose his job.
Actually, he may get to that point, but it'll be in steps. Because he actually, if you follow his career, there's a pattern he goes through, and people will bring certain things to his attention, and he'll laugh them off as being crazy and not knowing what they're talking about. And then a couple of years later, he'll finally adopt what they were saying and act like he came to this realization all on his own.
He is a very intelligent and well-spoken man.
Oh, he's very intelligent. He's very intelligent, but he did the last time he did this was with his last book, I think, was the Liberty Amendments, and he came out with all these ideas about the Constitutional Convention and all this stuff. But a couple of years before that, he spent like months railing against and name calling against Tom Woods and Kevin Gutzman and Mike Church, who had all been talking about not a constitutional convention, but an Article 5 convention. And he was calling them ridiculous, and they didn't know anything about the Constitution.
Mainly based off fear, because the fear is that the liberals are going to get too much to say if we have a constitutional convention.
A full-scale one. But no, like just the Article 5 convention, he made it seem like this was completely out of left field, and there was no way this could be done, and it would never solve anything. And a couple of short years later, he waited till he wrote his own book on the matter and put it out and made a pretty penny.
Yeah.
So and John, now he's claiming that they're the most wonderful thing in the world. So
John, like, has your daughter been homeschooled the whole time, or did you?
No, actually, we've only been homeschooling since October of past year, 2014. She did go to public school for kindergarten, which was an absolute nightmare and a total mistake. So anybody listening, if you have young kids who are not yet in kindergarten, I would not send them. I wouldn't even start sending them. It's prison. It's prison for kids. The socialization aspect, which these anti-homeschoolers are so crazy over, they get in trouble for talking. Their social contact is limited to a 20 to 30 minute block of over-supervised, over-maintained, and over-watched play time. It's monitored, it's watched. There's aides everywhere, and it's not socialization, because their normal social behavior of a child is discouraged.
Did you say aides?
Teacher's aides,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's what I was thinking, too.
Damn! I'm not going anywhere near a school.
Don't send your kid to public school. They all have aides.
See, Liberty reports that all... No.
Maybe it should have been teachers. I don't know. Teachers everywhere.
Aides everywhere.
John Alex Jones Moss.
Right. The syringes are all over the playground.
Oh, me. Shit.
Wow,
he said AIDS, and I was like, what the fuck is he saying? What?
You said she just went to kindergarten then, right?
She went to kindergarten. She was miles ahead of her peers in reading, but the rest of the school didn't seem to care. The teachers didn't care. They didn't really care about bumping her up, because we don't really do that. We don't really skip a grade. We can't really do that. So the end result was that she was bringing home these books. They're called decodables, and decodables they're literally watch Sally run. Sally ran fast, and she's getting bored with them. She doesn't even want to read them. She has no interest in them. It's destroying her love of learning, her love of reading. Yeah, public schools are just no good, man.
Yeah. Yeah, I definitely would agree with that. I actually recently got into a conversation. You know what I love to do when I'm on the, out the park, the playground, or a library, or, grocery store, wherever. If I meet somebody that's actually in school, like high school, middle school, I like to ask them a few questions. First of all, do you enjoy going to school? a lot of them give me this like jaded look, like they're, they're forced to say, yeah, I like it, but some of them say no. And I'm like, why? Oh, because I like to do this, but I can't do it. And then the other thing I ask them is, what's your favorite subjects? And And, you know, a lot of them say, you know, math or like biology or history. And like just yesterday, and just have an interesting story. I talked to a girl. She's like 13 years old. She's in eighth grade. And she was saying her favorite class is history. And so I said, really? So what about history exactly? Do you like? Oh, I like learning about the wars. Oh, really? So what are you learning about now? She said she's learning about World War II. And I'm like, oh, so like you mean like World War II brought us out of the Depression and things like that? She's like, yeah, exactly. Isn't that awesome? So I just started, you know, gently going into, you know, introducing her to, you know, isn't that strange? Don't you think that's a little bit strange that you know, a country that's bent on death and destruction, how does that bring prosperity? You know, how can that be good? If death and destruction is good, then should we just destroy our own houses and factories and buildings that would bring more prosperity because we would be employing the construction workers? And, you know, it's like the same, it's like the same logic is like, so if undertakers, if their business is dealing with dead people, so if more people died, then undertakers would be thriving, you know, in their business. So does that mean more people should die? No, you know, it's right, such right. Twisted logic. And then I was saying that, and she was really thinking about it, like, you know, I never thought of it like that.
Yeah, and that's the other thing too, is these government schools, and let's be honest and call them what they are. They're not public schools, they're government schools. They get government funding, the government tells them what curriculum to use. Yeah. So obviously, I mean, let's be real here. History was written by the winners. We all know that. So of course, everything that your child is going to learn is the U.S. government is good. Everything we did was for a good reason. Like, kids are actually going to school and coming out thinking that dropping an atomic fucking bomb on Japan and wiping out 250,000 people was a good thing. This is what public schools are teaching these kids. They don't learn about economics. They don't learn about the Federal Reserve. They don't learn about how their government works. They don't learn about taxation. They don't learn how to write checks. These kids come out of high school barely able to tie their shoes.
Well, not to mention that the entire government or the entire public school system is completely socialized. It's a whole social, and when you take that into consideration, you cannot logically point to one actual successful socialist program in the world.
Not one, ever.
So you're sending your kids to a program that will never work.
It's doomed to fail. And we don't really need to go through the whole statistic, but for those listening who might want a quick rundown, I mean, the U.S. spends more per student per year than any other country in the world, yet we're constantly in, you know, 14th, 15th in math, science. Cracking the top 10. And we spend more per student than any other country in the world. That should tell you that there is something fundamentally wrong with the education system. And what's the solution? They always say, throw more money at it. Why not print more money and throw more money at it?
Education reform.
Yeah, because that didn't work the first 100 years of public education. Let's keep trying it.
Yeah, not to mention, you know, the whole Baltimore thing is going on right now, or is kind of, you know, happening. And Baltimore, the city, Baltimore schools spend the most in the country per student. Spend $18,000 per student per year. And yet they have probably one of the highest dropout rates they have.
Yeah, I mean, and why are these kids dropping out? Because it's prison. They're not learning what they want to learn. They're discouraged to learn in most cases. They're being told that they're stupid through not passing the standardized testing. They're not teaching your kids how to think. They're teaching your kids what to think.
Well, that go to school for 8 hours or go sell heroin for 8 hours. What's going to make you more money?
Yeah, exactly. Sell heroin. And I don't fucking blame them one bit.
So John, can you explain your style of homeschooling or unschooling that you do?
Sure. Yeah, we use a method called unschooling, which was, I believe the term was coined by John Holt back in the 70s. And what unschooling is, if I can break it down into as layman as possible, unschooling is just simply living your life as if the construct of school didn't exist. There is no formal structure. There is no, okay, it's 9 o'clock, time to wake up, time to have breakfast, 10 o'clock, time for your math lesson, 11 o'clock, time for your recess. Like, there's just simply, like, I put it this way. When she was going to public school, it was like this. You would wake up at 7 in the morning, earlier, wake up at 6:30 in the morning, and then by 7 o'clock when the bus is coming around, it's, where's your shoes? I don't know. Where's your homework? You don't know where your homework is. Where's your lunch? Where's this? And it's 7 o'clock in the morning. I can't take it that early. And the best part of unschooling is, or even homeschooling, is you set your own schedule. I mean, we wake up when we feel like it. We eat breakfast when we feel like it. We get dressed for the day when we feel like it. There's no structure. There's no testing, there's no grades, there's nothing. The child just learns through natural life. And so unschooling is also called life-based learning. And that's exactly what it is. When they're really young, like mine is 7, the main focus is on play. Let them go out and play. Let them explore the world. They don't need to learn history right now. They don't need to learn, you know, all this stuff in school. And as far as the basics, they teach themselves. A great video that I can reference for anyone watching is a Larkin Rose video called The Need for Edumacation.
Yeah, I saw that. It's a great video.
15 minutes is perfect length. Yeah. And the synopsis of it basically is that when left alone, you teach yourself how to do things, and there's no better proof than when you were a baby, you taught yourself a language. And not only did you teach yourself a language, you taught it based on nothing. It's not like if someone wants to teach me Chinese, we can do that because I know English, they might know English, and you can say, okay, this means that, and that means this, and you have something to work with. When you're a baby, you have nothing. There's absolutely nothing going on, and you teach yourself how to speak a language. There's been studies done that when you leave kids alone with books, they teach themselves to read. The human mind is absolutely amazing what it's capable of doing. And the way it's capable of learning things, you just leave your child alone, and what they need to learn, they will learn. My daughter, she likes to set up a fake store all the time, and she has prices and her little cash register. And I mean, that right there, she's learning economics and math, making change, and she doesn't even realize it. She's just playing, and I'm there. Basically a stay-at-home dad. I change my hours. I work at a casino, so they're 24 hours a day, and I change my shift. I work 8 p.m. to 4 a.m. now, so I'm basically home all day with her, and we just do things like that, and she's learning math just through playing. Or I cook a lot, and I cook, I bake, and she helps me out in the kitchen. She's learning fractions, you know, a quarter cup of this, a half a tablespoon of this. She's learning math, and just by living your life, you learn so much more than being sat in an institution with 30 other kids exactly your age being lectured at by authorities.
You're not one of those asshole blackjack dealers that tells everyone to hit. Yeah, you should hit right there, man. I don't feel like I should hit. No, go ahead and hit. It's a smart thing to do. And then you bust. Ah, okay.
Only if you're not tipping. If you're not tipping, then I'm like, sure, go split tens. Yeah, that's a good move.
Don't split tens, boys.
You know, you were saying about the self-learning aspect of you know, young kids like that, and I truly believe that that's the reason that public institutions have been implemented, because the ruling class has always existed in some form or another. We've lived under some form of the state. Well, humanity has lived under some form of the state for 5,000 plus years. And with the schooling system, especially the one that we have to face here in the U.S., which is essentially, you know, the Prussian system that was brought over, the whole design of that is to be, like, you know, you were saying how it was very regimented even in kindergarten, which is just insane. Because, I mean, I remember kindergarten, and it wasn't that bad back then. I mean, it's obviously gotten worse. But they don't want free thinkers. They want that, they want it regimented. They want everything on a schedule. Because the whole idea behind the Prussian system was to create obedient citizens and, you know, passive participants in life.
Exactly.
So they didn't strike out against the state. So that's, you know, it's terrifying to people. And it's so funny because the indoctrination all of us receive for the most part, while we were growing up, kept us hidden from that, just like it did with our parents and you know, going back and back and back. So you get so many people, I can imagine, you know, I'm going to be homeschooling. I have twin girls and they're only 3 and a half right now. But that was one of the very few things my wife and I agreed with from the very start, because she was a special education teacher before they were born, and okay. I knew what my life was like after going to the public school system. So as soon as we started talking about children, we were like, yeah, we're gonna homeschool, and we're like, all right, great, we've got that agreed upon. but now it's gotten even worse with like the Common Core, how they just keep pushing and pushing. But so many people defend this because that's all they know, that's how they were brought up. They look at themselves and say, I turned out fine, not realizing that they were stifled as children, mm-hmm. and how, you know, or they just assume, oh, you need a teacher, you can't do it yourself, you can't let your kid learn. That's why people are paid to do that. Well, that's ridiculous. If you can't teach your kid how to do or allow them to teach themselves to do basic life functions, then you've got a lot more problems than sending them to school.
And yeah, you're absolutely right. They don't want free thinkers at all. I mean, they were modeled after the Prussian school systems, which, as you know, were indoctrination centers. And I mean, why do you think people get so out of control angry when they see like a flag burning video or something? Like, it's a piece of cloth. Who cares? It's my property. I'll burn it if I want to. Why are you getting so mad? And the answer is because of 13 years of the most formative time of their minds, of their lives, like this. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. So when you have that for 13 years and it's beaten into you day in and day out, that's all you know. And look what happens. You come out of school saying, oh, you should hate the government, not the flag. They're the ones who, you know, they're the ones who are doing it. Like, you don't get it. You weren't taught to freely think. You were taught to blindly obey.
So what always bothers me is the government wants law-abiding citizens, right? Law-abiding taxpayers. But yet there's two things they don't teach in public education. Law and tax, like how to pay your taxes.
Mm-hmm. Well, they need to fill up the prisons too, so they don't want you knowing about law.
No, yeah. They want to keep you in the dark on that, so they can say, "Oh, you're breaking this law that you know you knew nothing about."
They don't want free thinkers. They just want the schools are trying to crank out worker bees and soldiers, and that's it. That's all they're trying to do. That's why you see all the military recruiters there in high schools all the time. I mean, they want them. They want them young. They want them impressionable. They want this is what they want. They want to crank out tax cows and soldiers.
For sure.
Now I was just gonna say real quick. My in 12th grade, one thing that was interesting for me that I remember that stayed with me was in my economics class, which you know I assume taught basically Keynesian economics. But interestingly enough, he did teach he did mention three things that I thought were very remarkable for an economics class in high school. The first thing he said, he taught us about supply and demand, and the way he did it was it was seventh period, right? So it was like at the end of the day, right before going home. And so he's like, did anyone not have lunch, right? So one guy raised his hand, didn't have lunch. So he's like, all right, there's a box of donuts over there. Go over there, eat as many donuts as you can. and then after he talked a little bit, then he's like, all right, a scale of 1 to 10, how was the first donut? And like, he's like, it was awesome. It was 9, 10. And so he went down and it just like, you know, decreased. And it was just an awesome, very easy way to understand supply and demand. And the other thing he said was, Alan Greenspan is the most powerful man in the world.
Whoever tells Alan Greenspan what to do at that time was, yeah, sure.
Yeah, but I didn't fully appreciate that. He didn't really go into what the Federal Reserve was, and I didn't really fully appreciate that until many, many years later, like until I found out what the Federal Reserve. But that's all basically he said. Alan Greenspan is the most powerful man in the world. Understand that.
the general is not the most powerful man in the world. The military mind is not the most powerful man in the world. The man who funds him is the most powerful man in the world. Yeah. The bank who props up the war is the most powerful, because without that fuel, the engine of war can't run.
So the way I look at the teachers in government schools is I don't necessarily think that they're like wicked, like they're trying to, you know, stifle creativity. I just think that they're in a system that's completely inflexible and detrimental to the people in it. And they can't do anything about it. Their hands are tied, you know? And maybe the teachers really do want to teach their kids, you know, something valuable, but they just can't because they're in such a such an oppressive institution, you know? And,
yeah.
And that, and so, yeah, so these people, like I know a bunch of, you know, a couple of volunteers, like Katie Chaos. She's a teacher in the in a public school, and I mean, she came to volunteerism while she's teaching, so it's not like she started there while, you know, when she was volunteering, but she's trying to teach her kids like Bitcoin and various things like that. But of course, she's gonna leave very soon, the moment that gets, you know, more known that she's doing that.
Well, but, unless she's tenured. I mean, you can be, as long as you don't go in there and, like, shoot up a classroom as a teacher, if you're tenured,
yeah,
good luck.
That was going to be my next point, is why public schools are so bad is because they have these teachers' unions that lock them into these destructive contracts. It is literally impossible to fire a bad teacher. I mean, you pretty much have to try. Like, I mean, sexual assault on a student or blatant racism or something like that. I mean, you'd have to do something really, really horrible. And even then, you get, you know, your reviews and your, you know, tenure and this, that, and the other thing. So it's impossible to get these horrible teachers out of the school.
Yeah, what's the teacher in New York who just wasn't coming to work? He called in too many times, and so they put him on leave and then threatened to fire him. So then he sued the school system, and now he gets paid $180,000 a year to sit at his house and twiddle his thumbs.
Yeah, taxpayer money. So, I mean, you got to get your kids out of these places. These are the kinds of people that are educating your kids. You're better off educating them at home.
What's going to happen, though, when, like, so many people pull kids out of the school and all, like, let's say you have an area that has a school and let's go pie in the sky. 80% of the people don't want to, or aren't sending their kids to school or homeschooling somehow. Aren't the 80% going to be able to say, we're not paying for the public school here?
Yeah, I don't really know exactly how that works. That's definitely something that should be looked into.
I mean, we're a democratic nation, right?
Well, I would suggest that if that, you know, if that hypothetical number was reached in any area, they absolutely could pull out, because that's the only way that I see the tax structure being taken down without the entire system collapsing altogether would be, you know, mass noncompliance. You know, so many people are afraid to pay their taxes, whether it be income taxes or property taxes, which your school taxes are tied to, you know, because it's insane. You buy what you think is a piece of property that you own, and then you have to turn around and now pay rent to the government in form of a property tax, which your school tax are attached to. And even if you don't have children, and even if you never use the school system, you're required to pay for this monstrosity that is just, as you know, as you were saying, it's very destructive. And this is, you know, for me saying this, I was brought up by two educators. You know, I have a lot of teachers in my family, so I have like a lot of direct knowledge about this. And even they have said that it's just gotten progressively worse. And yeah. You know, my mom was a teacher for 30 something years, and she's finally retiring now. I mean, she still doesn't see the whole picture, but she's seen enough to say that it's a complete waste, and why should anybody have to pay for this? Why should anybody send their kids here to suffer through this? Because as you guys were saying, you know, the horrible teachers you can't replace, and the good ones, the ones that really have the best intentions, the ones that really want to help children, have their hands tied.
Yeah,
they can't, you know, exactly. You know, Danilla, you were saying about Katie, like there's only so much she can do because there's people watching her at all times. And I, you know, you were saying how, you know, with the you guys were joking with the tenure with her. Well, it would backfire on somebody like her because the unions have a vested interest in getting people like her out of the system as well, because she's a threat to them, because it's the teachers' union that keep everything going. And they're the ones, like you guys said, you know, get the contracts and this ridiculous amount of money. And people keep clamoring, oh, we need more money for education. Yeah, well, where's the money going now? The majority of it goes to bureaucratic administrative bullshit. And every time they add another $1 million, $2 million, $10 million, whatever it is to each program, all they're doing is just lining the pockets of the bureaucrats. Well, and the teachers will be lucky if they get a raise.
I'll give you guys a little story about how this public schooling is a boondoggle. I used to be one of like the super conservative people in my area. I used to go to like all these functions and talk, and I really started digging into the AEA. If you know what the AEA is, it's the Alabama Education Association. It's the largest union in Alabama, all right, other than Alabama Power. So the AEA has a bunch of state senators, not like big boy senators, but state senators on their payrolls. There's a few senators getting like $800,000 a year from these unions for a job. And you know what they do in this job? They do nothing. They show up once a year and, you know, oh, hey, you know, everything looks good here. My job's done. And then they walk back home, or they go home. And so I'm sitting here telling this to my aunt, who is a teacher, and I'm sitting here saying, your money is going to fund the Democrats, because that's majority who the AEA funds, is the Democrats. And she's a Republican, of course, and she's like, well, I have to be in the AEA, that you can't be a teacher without being in the union. So if that's just Alabama, I can't imagine what it's like in New York, what it's like in California, what it's like in a lot of the more heavily Democrat-ran blue states.
Right, which is why I'm so confused that Connecticut has such great homeschooling laws, because we are probably one of the top five psychotically liberal states in the union. So it's really cool. All I had to do to homeschool was I had to write a letter to the superintendent saying, effective immediately, I'm withdrawing my daughter from the Montville public school systems in accordance with CT statute, blah, 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 blah. Signed, myself and my wife signed it, and we turned it in, and that was that. That was that. She was out of school. She doesn't have to take any kind of testing. She doesn't need any kind of evaluation. It's really weird. As far as the state is concerned, she's out of public school, and it's literally my problem, which I couldn't be happier about.
So let's say she wanted to go to in 15 years, or she's 9, you said?
She'll be 7 very soon.
Okay, yeah. So she's 7, so in like 10 years. Let's say she wants to start ramping up to go to a college, a state-ran college, unfortunately. But let's say she wants to go to a college. Let's say she wants to go to UConn.
Sure.
How would you attack that?
Well, if homeschool kids want to go to college, I think that could be a good thing. Colleges seem to really like seeing homeschoolers on the application. And if she wants to get in, she can still take the I don't even know what they're called anymore. The SATs. The
ACT.
ACTs. Is the ACTs now? Well, whatever it is, she can take those. She can take any kind of aptitude test necessary to get into a college. She can take the same test.
Because I know you can, like, much like GED courses, you can also get there's ACT courses. I don't know in Alabama. I guess it's called the ACT. I don't know what it's called in other states. But I know you can go take ACT courses at colleges. They cost a little money, but they'll teach you how to pass and score well on that ACT.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and that's all open. Those are all options to her. She may not even want to go to college, which would be fine by me. I mean, not only for me not to pay $250,000 for her to go, but because I really think these student loans are absolutely the most destructive scam that's been perpetuated on these kids in a very, very long time. But that could get into a whole nother show. We could go 2 hours on that. But these student loans are no good, only to come out with a worthless degree and no job.
Let's talk about fears first. Like, I'm sure Jeremy and Danilo, whether they will admit it or not, have fears about this, you know, like about this whole thing. I mean, is there any kind of fear that you guys have that you want to maybe address that maybe John could probably, you know, like fire extinguisher, you know?
Well, I don't actually have any fears per se. I mean, there's always, I'm a very hypercritical person when it comes to myself, as you guys know, but I'm, so there's a part of me, I'm sure, that thinks I won't be good enough, but I don't really dwell on that. For me, I actually wanted to say, you know, John, you were saying that, you know, you're very lucky in Connecticut with the way it is, because that really is amazing, because here in New York, it's a nightmare. Like, we can write that letter, but then there are evaluations and there are tests that we have to keep up with,
right?
Because they want to keep tabs on you and they want to make sure that you're still teaching them something that they approve of versus what you want to do.
Yeah, I believe you still have to write like a letter of intent saying what stuff you're going to be teaching and all that stuff. So unfortunately for people in states that have those laws, I really don't have any kind of decent advice for that because I just don't know. We just don't do that in Connecticut. I would say look into your local laws and however you need to skirt around or go about it to unschool, I would take every measure.
That's been a point of contention with me and my wife. Like, you know, she wants it to be legit, you know, letter of intent, and then you get the packet of regulations and then, you know, evaluations and then periodic testing. And I just don't care about that. I don't think, really care what the state thinks of what we're teaching our kids. And I think that's just another way of kind of bowing to the state. And if you're already letting the state know that you're homeschooling and they have regulations and you're complying with those regulations, I think that those regulations will only increase with time in such a state as New York. And so you're just writing that letter of intent and letting them know you're homeschooling is just accepting that authority, that they have authority over your kids, even if you're homeschooling, you know, by sending that, you know, by complying with those regulations. So, like, but going back to what you were talking about, colleges and universities, that I get asked that a lot. Like, you know, your kid is not going to get a degree, you're not going to get a diploma. So what if they want to go to college? And I think that assumes a few errors. And one is that college and universities will actually exist when they are of that age, because I think the college and universities are truly dinosaur institutions that are on their way out right now. They're remnants of the past, because, you know, with the internet, you know, and lightning fast transmission of ideas, I just don't see the relevancy of an institution that charges thousands of dollars, you know, per class or per year to teach them information that they could easily get from piratebay.com. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. Or even online courses. It's just so outdated. Just like public schools are completely outdated and just dinosaur institutions. They're on their way out. And so the question is not, you know, what will you do if your kid wants to go to college? I think the question is, like, you know, will he even want to go to college? I don't think homeschooling kids will even want to go to college, because they'll see that it's a waste of time. Why would they want to sit in a place like that when they're going to learn outdated knowledge?
Yeah, you should be sending them to how to successfully navigate and use the internet to acquire knowledge classes. That's the only thing you should be doing. Me and my girlfriend kind of got into a big argument. Well, not big. We haven't really gotten into any big arguments, but we kind of got into an argument, and I said, look, there's no reason why right now every kid shouldn't be mailed a And I put your brakes on and just listen to what I'm saying. If we have to have public schooling, and my tax dollars are going to this, there's no reason why every kid doesn't have a pre-programmed iPad sent to their house or whatever government-issued box that could teach them all these things that their teachers are saying you'd save on building that school, paying that plumbers and et cetera, et cetera. Just you understand what I'm saying here. That price of that iPad, and hell, even paying for the internet connection for it, if you wanted to really socialize this up, would be a hell of a lot cheaper than paying for all these school districts to exist, all of these frickin' teachers to have insurance and stuff. You know, if the teachers can't even teach, they're basically handed a manual. Hey, this is what you have to teach. If you go outside these lines, if you draw outside the lines, you're out of here.
Yeah, you make a good point, and I do understand that. But the schools are not worried about efficiency, because it's not their money. It's your money. And your
exactly.
Money.
Exactly. Government is a boondoggle.
It's a tragedy of the commons right there.
They're not interested in efficiency. But yeah, that would be the smart thing to do.
I guess I'm thinking too much like a capitalist.
Which they don't teach in schools. If the teachers' unions got out of the way, the federal government got out of the way, and let public schools at least, I mean, if it's going to be tax-funded, at least be on a local level and keep the federal government out of it, sure, it would run a lot more efficiently. That said, I still am very much in favor of unschooling and homeschooling, because even with that awesome iPad and the internet connection, your child is going to be pumped full of whatever information the government wants them to learn. So while, yes, that would be a more efficient way to do it, I absolutely agree with that, it still doesn't beat homeschooling.
I guess it's me trying to figure out a problem that government creates, trying to fix it with government, which we all know can't work. But what I'm doing is appeasing anyone that's had this thought as well. Because I've had this thought with the USPS forever. You take the USPS, and then you mail everyone a device that just, whenever the USPS gets a piece of your mail, they throw it into a scanner, it shows up on your device.
No, but the idea that the government should be efficient is not the problem, right? We have to step back. You know, we oppose the government not because it's inefficient, but because it's immoral, right?
Taxation is theft. Oh, for sure. I'm playing devil's advocate here.
So yeah, but I'm just saying. So regardless if it's, you know, inefficient, like you don't want the thief to be efficient, right? You don't want the rapist to be efficient, right?
No, you don't.
We don't want thieves and rapists. We oppose immorality.
It seems the only thing the government is actually efficient at is bombing and killing people. In my opinion, at this point in time in history, we can go back and talk like some crazy constitutionalist patriot that says, oh yeah, the government was really good at doing this back in the day. But at this point in time, in 2015, it seems to me the only thing the government does well, barely, is blow people up and build military bases.
Well, yeah. I'd say they're actually very good at that. And they're also a pretty darn good thief. But you know what you were saying about the school, Dave, you know, I would tend to lean more with John on this because, you know, I mean, I know you're just playing devil's advocate, but as he said, they would still control what goes on. And the biggest problem with public schooling, I think, outside of the government intervention and all that, you know, even for the people that, like I said, the teachers that actually want to be doing something good and the people that honestly believe that, you know, they're happy to pay their taxes towards the public schools because they want an educated populace around them. Like, you know, those people exist. And for them, I think the biggest problem is getting them to understand that under pretty much no circumstance ever does one size fit all. And that's what it boils down to. No matter how you design public education, whether you go Dave's route, which again, I think for efficiency purposes, I agree with John perfectly. Because I've actually had the same idea, I've had the same discussion with people. So on that end, it would work perfectly. But it's still trying to get one size to fit all, and that will never work. And you know, as you guys were saying before about, you know, college, even if kids do want to go to college, not all kids should go to college. And that's another thing that's drummed into kids through the school system is you got to go to college, you got to go to college, you got to go to college. You know, there's this.
That's because our parents, that generation, the baby boomers, so to say, it was actually really smart for you to go to college if you could afford it, if you could pass it, if you could actually get out and do it and get a college education. Now, where Tom, Dick, and Harry have a college education, it's pointless.
Well, they're getting useless degrees, too. I mean, you have kids coming out of college like, all right, I got my degree in 15th century Korean literature. And like, what are you going to use that for? Well, you're not going to use that for anything. But there's these worthless educations.
15th century Korean literature.
<You're right.
laughs> Wait, is that North Korea or South Korea?
North Korea, best Korea!
Well, 15th century was still one if it existed, right?
So. True. There was no
Korea in the 15th century. No, I'm confused. Korea. Wait a minute. See, look at this. We've all been duped by public education.
See that? That's a reflection of our education.
Would that be? I can't.
I made that up. Whatever.
No. It was quick. It was funny. No, it cracks me up for sure. That cracks me up. People, they get frivolous degrees, and you know, like I'm a poli sci major. Like, okay, what the fuck are you gonna do with that?
Yeah.
Or I gotta
like government.
No, it just. I have a buddy who is not a smart fellow, but did a 2-year. Well, what I would consider smart, he's probably smart in some. Smart is being intelligent is relevant. A lot of people don't understand that. But you know, he went 2 years and got a 2 years into a apprenticeship, and now he's making more than anybody that I know that has a college degree. So, yeah. Like, what the fuck are you, like, Cat, like CAT, the tractor company or whatever that makes all these huge, they are a government subsidized company by and large, but you can go get a 2 year training program for them, come out as a crane operator and be making $100,000 a year. Or you can go to public school and they pay for all that. Or you can go to, you know, state ran college institutions, get out, be 40 grand in debt, not pay that off to your 40. No one's going to hire you because you're all overqualified. The jobs for your degree don't exist anymore, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But people don't like, oh, I don't want to be a crane operator. Doesn't matter. You got mouths to feed, motherfucker.
I would say I don't think it, you know, whether people want to go to college or not, because there are still some things right now in the system that we find ourselves in that, you know, if people really want to pursue those avenues, they don't have a choice but to get the fancy degree because they won't get the job. You know, hopefully I tend to agree with Danilo. I think things are being phased out for the better. Although they're going to go down kicking and screaming. But I like to think at least, you know, within 20, 30 years, they will start being, you know, more people will be using the online things. But even now, if kids want to, you know, one of the books that I read when my kids were first born and I, you know, we'd already decided that we were going to homeschool once they reached the age, I actually read Ron Paul's book that he came out with, The School Revolution, back in 2013. And, you know, a lot of the stuff I had already known because I had been thinking about homeschooling for a while. But the one thing I came across that I thought was really interesting was that you're not taught this and this is kind of withheld from you. And he actually explains it in the book that it's kind of withheld from you from people in the state, that in most states, if you do homeschool and you do it, you know, the kids learn enough, and even if you're in a state where you have to, you know, like I am in New York, where you have to follow their evaluation schedule and all that, you can actually have the kids, without pushing them, you know, ridiculously hard, learn enough to pass the state's, you know, required tests to have them, you know, pass out of their senior year at 16. And then if they want to go on to college, they can take two additional years in a combination of homeschool type setting, where at 18, if they really want to go to an actual university, they will join their friends, but they will be starting as a junior.
Right.
So if they have a passion that requires a degree under the current paradigm, and they, you know, they want to go that route, you're saving yourself 2 years worth of tuition. And
oh, sure.
they're two years ahead of everybody else,
mm-hmm.
You know, and again, that the only thing that people come back with that is then they start coming up with the ridiculous, you know, their fears, you know, like, you know, you touched on briefly earlier, John, about the socialization aspect, and all that stuff, you know, that's what most people fear, which is just ridiculous. I mean, I've always been of the opinion that, you know, even if you take out of the equation that, yeah, the socialization in public schools itself is screwed up because that's where the bully cultures grow. Mm-hmm. You know, even if you take that out of the equation, for me, I always looked at it like, well, if we're supposed to believe that this is school for education purposes, what the hell does socialization have to do with that in the first place? You're supposed to be learning. Like, if you want it to be taken seriously, like that's the purpose of it. Like, why does socialization matter? You know, most kids end up playing, you know, either in a little league or soccer or some sport, or you find, you know, groups in your area. Like most kids, you know, I grew up like that. Most people I know grow up like that. You know, you find different things anywhere where you're socializing outside of the school setting.
Yeah, all of my socialization came after school when all the neighborhood boys would get together and play baseball.
Exactly. So, like, it's
like
that's just
school was terrible. Everyone, no one wanted to be there.
Yeah.
It was like, fuck, I can't wait to get out of school so I can go play baseball.
Yeah, the whole how will they socialize is literally the homeschool equivalent of who will build the roads. It's the most common question I get asked when I talk about homeschooling. And, yeah, there's so many things you can do. I mean, there's karate, there's baseball, there's basketball, there's gymnastics, there's Cub Scouts. I mean, the list goes on and on and on.
Not to mention how ridiculous it is for kids to be together with kids of the same age. Like, right. That doesn't happen in nature. If there was no, if we all, like, think about it like that. You know, like, back in the day, they put all the school kids in the same classroom. Mm-hmm. You'd have 30 kids, all of them different ages. Now, all 8-year-olds in one class, all 9-year-olds in one class, all 10. That's unnatural. That's not how reality works.
Exactly, exactly. In homeschooling, you can really set your own terms with that. And the other thing with the non-socializing is that, I mean, people, we live in the age of the internet. It is now easier than ever to hop online and within a couple of keystrokes connect to an entire community of homeschoolers in your area. Recently, we went to a homeschool meet and greet at there's a drive-in movie theater about an hour north of us in Rhode Island. It's this old-style drive-in movie theater. They're one of like two left in, you know, the area. Usually it's $25 to get a whole carload of people in. This night, you know, they have to test the projectors and get the popcorn thing going. So they opened it for free to this one specific homeschool group on Facebook because I guess the owner knew a member or something like that. I'm not sure. But so it was free for everybody. It was homeschoolers everywhere. And we opened up our car door and we told our daughter, we were like, go run, go socialize, go play. And she made a friend like that. And they ended up sitting at their car and watched the whole movie together at their car. They had their blankets and glow sticks and everything. It was really adorable. But I mean, the point is it's so easy to hop on Facebook and make play dates with people in your area. So the socialization thing is really such a non-issue.
Danilo's the master of play dates.
Yeah, I'm the stay-at-home father. I guess like similar to you, right? So your wife works, right? Right, John? And you she works during the day, and you.
Well,
and
he
you're,
works
you're
as well.
I mean, yeah, I mean, you and she works during the day, right? And you're with the kids right. During the day. Yeah.
Yeah, so, I work 8 to 4. And it works for us because I come home, it's about 4:30 in the morning when I get home. Mm. And I mean, I can do what I need to for an hour or two. I can eat and unwind, watch TV or whatever. I can sleep. My wife goes to work and I can sleep until 11 or noon. My daughter is so self-sufficient. She's taught herself how to do everything. She makes her own breakfast. She changes herself. She gets her own morning routine done. Nice. And by the time I come downstairs, she's quietly watching TV, and she's, hey, hi, Daddy.
We
go about our day.
The socialization is kind of funny because I think a lot of parents assume like what do you think I'm doing? You think I'm like locking my kid in a room and throwing books at him, and that's it? That's what I'm doing? You know, like, no, I'm like you said, connecting with people through email, through Facebook, through social media. You know, I'm constantly calling parents, like setting up play dates. Where do you want to meet this time? You want to go to a museum? You want to go to the park? Where do you want to go? You know, and I'm constantly doing new things. And my kids, you know, they're always asking, are we going to meet new kids today? And they get so excited. I have my son's going to be 5 in next month in June, and my daughter's going to be 3 in August. Mm-hmm. And they're very assertive, right? They have no problem. They're not shy at all. They go up to adults, you know, anybody, and they just say, hi, my name is Marcus. My name is Serena. You know, not shy at all. And it's just amazing how it flies in the face of this ridiculous socialization myth, you know?
It does, and they're getting the wrong kind of socialization when they go to public school. You've got bullies, you've got drug dealers.
Yeah, exactly.
You've got all these pregnant teenagers. You've got all the riffraff of society, the riffraff of the teenage society, all condensed into one place at once. I mean, it's amazing they get any kind of positive socialization out of it. Mm-hmm. And even then, they can't, so even if they do make a decent friend, they can't socialize. They get in trouble for talking during class. And that their recesses are, what, 20 to 30 minutes of over-monitored, over-regimented, you know, play time, where it's monitored, there's teachers watching everything you do, and it's just, it's not real socialization. I mean, these kids need to be free. You got to set them free on a playground and just let them live life and let them learn.
Yeah, I mean, my school that I went to was the number one, by the state standard, the number one drug school, you know, kids on drugs or whatever, in the state of Alabama. And it was a middle class area with a 90% white student ratio.
It's easier to get LSD in, do kids even still do LSD anymore? I don't know. But
they did when I was in high school.
At least when I was,
they did.
It was easier to get a hit of acid than it was to get like alcohol or cigarettes or anything.
Oh, I used to love that. You know, like if you found somebody that could buy you beer, it was always somebody's older brother.
Oh yeah.
But to find weed, it was like, hey, has anybody got weed?
Yeah.
Like five people be like, yeah, I got you.
Dave, I just want to correct you. So now today is two classes of drugs. You got the illegal drugs, and then you got the legal drugs. You got Ritalin, Prozac, and Adderall.
Oh yeah.
Right?
If you see a kid, right? Yeah. If you see a kid with an Altoid box, 100% that kid. Well, back when I was in school, 100% that kid's got prescription pills in that mother frig.
Yeah. Well, that's actually what makes the public schools even more dangerous, because you know most of the older generations of parents, and even some of the newer ones, think that the quote unquote illegal ones are the problem. Well, no, it's the legal ones that are being pumped out through the schools.
What's the statute of limitation on selling illegal drugs or prescription drugs here? Does anybody know?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Okay, well, never mind. I'm not going to incriminate myself. Never mind.
Well, they have, you know, they pump these, you know, first and second graders, they're pumping with Ritalin and stuff, you know, the whole ADHD craze.
I was on it for 9 years. I quit taking it. I refused to take it. I would sell it all.
Well, those come through the school psychologists, you know, because the public education system and the government education system and the teachers' unions are hooked up with the pharmaceutical companies, and you know they cross promote each other. Basically,
never thought about that. Never thought about that. Wow.
Yeah, you follow the money just like with anything else when it comes to government. You follow the money and you find out who's supplying who, and that's why certain things happen. And that's the culture that is nowadays.
I really don't know how, just from high school, I don't know how I'm not in prison. I really don't. I got lucky. Honestly, I had eight really good friends die from 9th to 12th grade from drug overdoses or drug-related incidents. Yeah. You take that in consideration to where – it was harder to find a case of beer than it was to find a 20 sack of weed or a script of Xanax. Like, do people not realize that? Like, okay, if you legalize it, it's harder for your youth to get. It's harder for your kids to get. And I know I'm not making a case for legalization here, and I'm not making a case for government control on something. I'm just saying that when you put roadblocks up like that, it's harder for kids to get into that shit. Mm-hmm. And like when you're homeschooling your daughter, she's not going to be, she may later in life when she's mentally adept at being able to handle a situation like walking up to five people and them saying, hey, do you want a Xanax? Every one of us are doing it. That's not going to happen at your house. That's not going to happen at a play date. That's not going to happen at soccer. That's not going to happen at whatever else. Because you're going to be there to be able to protect her from that scenario. But when your mom and dad or the bus is coming to pick you up and they drop you off at school and no one's there to watch you because the teachers don't give a shit, no one gives a shit.
Well, it's not so much protecting her, but we're able to teach her to make the right decisions. Like when you're in public school, they jam this dare shit down your throat that doesn't do anything. And all it is, it's all fear-mongering. I mean, you know, they told us marijuana will kill you. They tell you all this bullshit.
Oh, the dare just got burned hard. Did you see that?
And you find out that it's all, you find out that none of it's true, and then you don't take any of it seriously, where you can control that in homeschooling. Actually, if we can rewind a little bit, there's something that Danny said a little while ago I really, really wanted to touch on, was that, okay, we've spent this podcast discussing how horrible these student prisons are, and you want to get your kids out. But another common thing I hear is that I'm just too afraid. I'm afraid I'm too stupid to teach my kid. I'm unqualified to teach, and I can't do it, and blah, 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 blah. No, you're not too stupid. You're not underqualified. You don't need a qualification to help guide your child on the path of learning that they want. And that's really a big cornerstone of unschooling, is that they follow their interests. For example, if my daughter wants to own a bakery someday, we'll say, for example, she wants to own a bakery and have her own business, she doesn't need to learn about the War of 1812 or, you know, Magna Carta, you know, any of these useless tidbits of trivia that she just doesn't need. She can focus on exactly where she wants to go, whether, you know, if she wants to own a bakery, she'll learn how to bake, and she goes that route, and then she can learn business and economics and go that route and you know, focus her education on those two things and probably churn out a pretty decent business. So that's really what you're doing. You're just there to guide. You're not there to say, okay, junior, 2 + 3 = 5. This is how you did this and this. You're just there as a guide, and your child will take their own path. Kids are so curious and they want to learn everything that when you leave them alone, they will take their own path. It's amazing. I mean, my 6-year-old was really into reading for a while. And we actually finished Huckleberry Finn together. I don't know too many 6-year-olds who read Huckleberry Finn. They're busy with this See Sally Run shit in their schools.
Yeah, you know, I you're right. You know, kids do have a natural desire to learn, and I think, you know, curiosity is the first education. You know, and that's one of the first things that's beat out of them. You know, when you go to a government school, is what you want to learn is not important. This is what you have to learn, not what you want to learn, right? And it's like whatever your interest, even if you were starting to get interested in a particular topic in school, like the bell rings, stop thinking about it and go to your next class.
That's a good point. I never thought of that. Yeah.
It's like a military, you know. And whenever I talk to people, like anywhere I am, right, anywhere I go, I try to talk about homeschooling and unschooling. I talk very openly. Like, I think some parents are more quiet about it, you know, they don't want to stir the water, but me, you know, if somebody asks me, I say I'm homeschooling, I'm the stay-at-home homeschooling father, and most of the time I get met with interest. You know, people say, oh wow, so how are you doing that, what are you doing, you know, so I get a chance to explain it, and then if I get them really interested, then I get their contact information, and then I send them, one of the first things I send them is Josie Wales' video, A Prison by Any Other Name.
I don't know if you,
that's one of my favorite videos to send people about government school and what it's about. And it's basically a comparison of prison to government school. And it is like parallel comparison, you know, no freedom of association, no freedom of speech. You know, everything is regimented. The bell, you know, the bell determines everything. You know, you appeal to authority, you know, you can't solve problems with your peers, you know, it's just amazing how it's so similar, you know, and then, you know, the formation of the bullies, you know, it's just everything.
And then,
is right.
And then when you go to college, they're like, yeah, all that shit they taught you in high school, we don't do that shit like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, we're going to have to retrain you how to learn. That's why you have to go to college. And then they're like, you need to take English, math, science as your core classes because they want to teach you how they teach.
That's a great point about the bell signifying stop thinking about this, start thinking about this. Like, you know, the student's in art class and they're really getting into it, and all of a sudden, ding, 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 stop thinking about art. It's math time. Now you have to totally change gears and go to this new class and get your book out, and you're still thinking about your art project. But no, stop this and start thinking here. It's so destructive to learn.
Square is square peg, round hole.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I think that's, you know, that whole aspect is one of the most destructive things, because it causes kids that can't work like that, which it's unnatural. It is, but some kids can adapt to that. But the ones that can't, it makes them feel stupid, or because either they're not allowed to, they're not given the time to ask the questions they want, or the topic changes, or they move on to the next class, and then they feel like they're behind because they lose interest in these other classes, and it makes them feel dumb. And then the kids that come out with the really high grades have this inflated sense of themselves because they've been praised as being smart, but all they've been taught to do is memorize garbage.
I'll give you guys a situation on this whole thing, just to explain this, Jeremy. When I was I hate homework because that's not how I learn. I learn through doing. And when I was in high school, I took AP classes because AP classes didn't need they didn't give homework. It was all tests. And I took Calculus 1, which was the highest math class you could take at my school. I took that my junior year for my math class for the year, right? Because you had to take a math every year. You had to take a history every year. You had to take a science, whatever, every year. My senior year, I took pre-cal. Now, I passed Cal 1 with like a 93, all right, my junior year. Senior year, I told the teacher who taught me in Cal 1, I'm not going to do any of your homework. I made a 98, 95 on every test she gave, and she still gave me a D in the class because I refused to do homework. Like, that's how stupid public schooling is.
It's bad. Yeah, the other thing, another myth that I would like to address is the myth of, well, not really a myth, more of a question that I get is, yeah, just like you said, Danny, people get curious. They say, oh, you homeschool, and they start asking questions. And one question that I get a lot is, well, what do you have to buy? What kind of materials do you need? How much money do you spend per school year on what you do? And I tell them, well, it costs me whatever you pay for an internet connection. That's about it.
I mean, wow.
So, which you likely already have anyway. You're likely already spending your $50 a month or $60 a month on your high-speed internet. Between YouTube and Google, I mean, there's nothing you can't search for and find and learn about. There's nothing you can't learn on the internet. Give your kid an internet connection, teach them what Google and YouTube are, and set them free.
Yeah, even if you want to go the slightly more structured route of, you know, just plain homeschooling, and you don't want to go the homeschooling, there's stuff like the Khan Academy, which is free online.
There's other
programs, you know, like Ron Paul's coming up with his own curriculum. There's other stuff out there like that are, you know, well, I mean, his, for example, is free for kindergarten through fifth grade, and then they start charging in sixth grade. But even programs like that are not as expensive as people think, because people think of, they think of the cost of education in terms of what they pay in school taxes, which, right, as we've discussed already, you know, most of that goes to bureaucracy and doesn't actually touch the kids themselves. You know, the teachers get a salary from it, but even that's paltry compared to what the rest of the administration is getting. Right. So people think in those terms, oh, school is so expensive. No, it's not. You know, I have friends that, you know, there's a movement here on, even on Long Island, where there's people that trade. In like one person will pay for it 1 year, and then they'll trade it the next year to somebody else, and then just starts getting passed around to other people, you know, and you share stuff, or you can purchase, if you know, like I said, if you want to follow a more structured system, you know, you can buy these curriculums used, you can, you know, you can mix and match stuff. So yeah, I mean, you're taking it to the complete lowest level with just the internet connection, but you're right, that is all you need. But it really is fear, and that's driven into people. And for, I really think that has to do with, you know, the whole status paradigm, where it's, you know, you're taught to look to experts for answers to things. So that's why teachers are, you know, well, they're the experts, they have the degrees. It's like, no, yeah, some of them are great people, some of them are very smart people, but you don't need a degree to teach. All you have to do is love your damn kids and want to see them succeed. It really is as simple as that. Like, if you don't, I mean, some people may think I'm being a dick about this, but if you don't love your kid enough to be willing to put the effort in, then you should really rethink your parenting position, because it's not that hard. And with the fact that your kids will most likely be willing to learn, as long as it's, you know, something they're interested in, like we've been talking about, you know, that's what I plan on doing. You know, I have my daughters, they're identical twins, but they already have their own personalities, and they're already showing interests in certain things. And that's it. You find what interests them.
Are you going to dress them up like The Shining?
No. going back to the LSD conversation, I have a horrible story that maybe we'll get into another episode about tripping on LSD.
I have a few horrible stories as well.
No, but directly related to The Shining while being at Fordham University.
Oh, God.
So, but we'll get into that in another episode.
Things not to watch while tripping. Shining is on that list.
I wasn't watching it. I was living it. That's all I'll say for now. But, you know, it really is. It's, you know, If your kids, when you allow them to, they have passions, they have things they want to learn, you know, like both, you know, Danilo and John, both of you said, you know, your kids get interested, they get excited about things, you know, and I see that in my kids who are, you know, a little bit younger, but you see that, you watch them and they want to learn because they don't know anything. How else do you learn? But you ask questions, you know. I know a lot of people that get agitated with kids at the, you know, the 3-year-old stage when it's why, 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 why.
But
I love they're that. Trying. They're,
I love that.
Yeah, because they're trying to learn. They want to know. Like my kids, I love it. They love to help me cook, you know, because I do the cooking at the house. So they love watching me cook. And just like John said, you know, I was teaching them measurements today as I was because I make homemade almond milk for them. And I was teaching them, you know, we were using the measuring cup. And I was, you know, it's like all these little things people don't think of. And it's that fear because it's been beaten into your head that, you know, the teachers are there for a reason. You can't possibly have that knowledge. Well, if you really think that you're that inept, it's even more important that you teach your kids these things because you can relearn it with them. You know, that you know, Dave, you said asked earlier about the fears. Like originally that was one of my things. Well, like what if I get to a point where I don't know something anymore? But then when I thought about it, it's like, well, then I can learn with them. You know, I can relearn this stuff. And it's
you're
like,
You're an adult. You can't learn anymore. Come on.
Well, because people, you know, that goes back to something Dave said in a lot of other episodes about people being afraid to say, I don't know. Yeah, you have to get over that because you think you were taught these things and whether you understand that it was, you know, indoctrinated garbage that was beaten into your head or not, it's still like you forget that stuff. So like it's okay to say, I don't know.
I don't know does not equal white flag waving, okay? Because when you're making that assertion, it's almost like when your boss comes in. I don't know if you guys work in you know, it would almost be like your pit boss coming in and saying, why haven't you done this? I will get back with you on this. That's the better answer than saying, I don't know. But there's some things that we don't know that we have to say, I don't know. And I will get back with you on this once I figure it out. There's a reason why I know everything about Scientology. There's a reason why I know all this shit about bullshit. It's because when something piques my interest, I have to know everything about it. And that's why I became a voluntarist. Mm-hmm. I was like, what's voluntarist? What's anarchy? What's this? I had to know everything about it. I had to read everything about it.
I think John mentioned earlier about learning and, you know, the curiosity for learning. And I wrote a small article a few months ago called Learning and Living Are Inseparable, right? There is no such thing as living without learning. Life is about learning. Life is education, right? And this obsession that people have when they think that the only time that a kid can learn something is between the ages of, you know, 5 and 17, and if they don't learn anything, if they don't learn anything that year, they're doomed. That's it. There's no hope. Right. Because when you're an adult, you don't learn at all, right? No, we don't learn. And it's just a very sad thing. Like it's like almost like we're scared, or people are scared, to just let their kids, you know, do what feels natural to them, to just have fun. Like having fun is almost like a threat. I feel like some parents feel like they feel threatened when you just say, no, I just let my kid play. You know, I do free play, free unstructured play, and they learn through play. What? Well, how are they going to learn how to read, how to write, how to do math, how to do blah, blah? You know? It's like if they need to know, they're going to learn. Like, do you honestly believe in the age of, you know, iPhones and iPads and iPods and laptops, computers, and the internet, that they're not going to learn how to read or write when there's people are, that's how people communicate? You know, are you seriously think that your kid is that stupid that they're not going to pick that up, because they will have to pick it up if they want to communicate with the rest of the world, right?
For sure. Like John, do you speak Romanian? Do you speak Romanian, John?
Do not speak Romanian.
Okay, if I picked you up right now, if I was God, I picked you up and dropped you in Romania or wherever the hell they speak Romanian, in 6 months' time, you would be speaking Romanian because you either adapt or die.
Romania doesn't exist. No, I'm just kidding.
Japan, Japanese, Korean, it doesn't matter where the fuck.
I'm actually doing that at work because there's such a heavy Chinese clientele at the casino. That just from dealing with them day in and day out every day, I'm starting to pick up some basic Mandarin. You know, it's nothing more than like, hi, how are you, motherfucker, you know, little things like that.
The important stuff.
Yeah, the very important stuff.
But yeah, you know, when you're around it so much that you just tend to pick it up. One of the questions that I would get when I describe what unschooling is that they say, okay, there's no structure at all. there's no structure. What if, well, God, what if your daughter wants to just sit around and play Minecraft all day? And
I exactly. kind of look at,
and I kind of look at them and I say, I let her. And you could see their heads just explode. Like, what? Like, you let her play video games all day and watch TV all day? They say, yeah. Like, you leave them alone, let them learn. If they get bored of TV, which they will, they'll move on to something else. See, Unschooling was introduced to me last year at Porkfest. They had a homeschool meet and greet. Porkfest, for those who might not know, is the annual Porcupine Liberty event up in New Hampshire every year. I was talking to a couple of ladies who were unschooling their daughter, and I went to learn more about homeschooling, and they said, unschooling, I had never heard that term before. So in talking with them, that's what I asked. I said, well, what if your son wants to play video games all day? And she says, well, I let him. And I thought these ladies were absolutely out of their mind, that shit crazy. You know, letting your kids play video games all day, like what could that possibly accomplish?
Can you be my dad? Because that shit was taken away from me. Yeah, the console, oh, yeah. The Super Nintendo was hidden.
If you let them, if the passion is there. One of them told me a story about somebody she knew. Her son was just video games, video games, video games. He was so into it, and that's all he did every day. And he eventually learned computer programming, and he eventually learned how video games are made. And now he works for, I haven't played video games in like 10, 15 years, so I don't really know who's who anymore, but he now works for some really huge game company. Maybe it's EA or Activision, or I don't really know any of the companies anymore, but he works for a really big that's what he does. It's his passion was video games, and he followed it, and that's where it led him. Your kids want to learn. They will get bored of TV. They will get bored of, you know, doing monotonous, stupid things, video games, whatever. And, you know, they have their places and all that. But, just leave them alone. Leave them alone and let them learn. Let them guide themselves. Be their guide, but don't be their statist ruler. Don't tell them what to do or how to do it. Let them, you know, don't be afraid to let them make mistakes, too.
I actually, that's a good point. You bring up something that I was talking to a guy, this family, like I think it was like 2 months ago. My wife and I went to a wedding with her coworkers, and one of her coworkers, they have a 7-year-old daughter and a 10-year-old son, and I asked them, and they go to government school, of course, but I asked them, what is your daughter into, the 7-year-old, right? And they say, oh, they're so excited. It's like, oh, my daughter's into volleyball. She's into basketball. She does all these wonderful track and field. She's very athletic. And they're so happy and proud, right? And I'm like, all right, so what is your son into? And then they just got this really depressed look. Oh, all he wants to do is just play video games. And they're just so disappointed. And I'm like, what's wrong with that? And they're like, I don't see a future. I'm like, and then I started talking about, you know, how the whole idea that fears that scares people is because I think they think that they know the future. Like, they know if you play video games right now, you're gonna end up, you know, as a bum on the street or in prison or whatever, just a loser in life, right? They think they know the future. But how can you possibly know the repercussions of actions right now, you know, and what that's going to lead to in 5, 10, 15 years, right? 20 years. We have no idea where that's going to lead to. But anything that's ever successful, or any inventor or somebody who's really creative, it's always started out with something that they're passionate about. And they had no idea that it was going to lead to, you know, did Steve Jobs, could he envision the iPhone back when he was like a teenager? You know, I don't think so. You know, but things, they build and they lead up to something, and you have, and once, when you're denying your kids doing something that they actually enjoy passionately, you're really destroying their potential. You're destroying their future, and you're supplanting it with a future that you think is best for them, but actually is, it's like we're teaching them, you know, ancient knowledge that is no longer relevant, but that's what we think is important. But maybe it's not relevant to their lives. Maybe they're never going to need to know, you know, Euclidean geometry. You know, maybe they're going to invent a new geometry, you know? So by us forcing ancient knowledge on them, we're depriving them of their creativity. and imagination. Right. So
they need to learn it. They'll learn it.
This will probably be the last thing I say in the show if we're wrapping up. But to quote the great Gary Vaynerchuk, he said, I don't care if my kids, he's got two kids in school. He said, I don't care if they both fail out of school and get kicked out. He said, to be the smartest person in the room has never been less important in the entire history of humans. He said, for instance, who's the 12th president? I don't know, this guy. So all this shit you have in your head is pointless when someone can go, oh, 12th president, boom, right here.
It's useless trivia. That's all they're pumping your kids' minds with in public school. Useless tidbits of trivia.
There's stuff. There's those intangibles, you know. It's like they talk about football players. Oh, he's got intangibles. Well, that means that's stuff that you can't teach. Leadership, stuff like that. You can't teach someone to be an actor. You can go to acting school all you want, but you can't be Tom Cruise from going to acting school. You can teach. You can go to all the culinary schools you want, but there's one Gordon Ramsay. You can't learn to be Gordon Ramsay.
Yeah.
You, et cetera. This goes on to everything. It's all, you either got it or you don't. And there, all this pointless, mindless bullshit that they want to throw on top of the human experience at the prime years. Like, if you think about this logically, if we jump back 100 years, people died around 30, 35. If they went to school like it's set up now, they graduated 18, and then for 10 years they get to do what they want with their life.
Yep.
So it's just a little ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Like I said, I'm looking forward to homeschooling my kids, unschooling more precisely, because that's the route I would personally like to go with them. I really want people that watch this, if you still send your children to public school, or if you still think it's a good idea, if you're one of those people that pays into it because you, even though you don't have children and you think it's helping people, you know, try examining the numbers a little bit. You know, I know plenty of people who claim to, but then they still come back and say, oh, well, we need these things and we need to pay the teachers. It's like, why? What has it actually done for you? You know, if you're a product of public school, you know, how far do you think you've really gotten? You know, you have this lifestyle that was almost predetermined for you because that's the way the system was designed. The system was designed to churn out workers. It was designed to churn out, you know, the obedient citizens that believe this rhetoric that gets tossed around that, you know, without the government schools, there would be no schools. You know, I think I touched on this on another one of our shows about the parent-based private schools that are going on in India. Like, you look around the world, like, people are figuring this stuff out, and it, you don't need to have your money extorted from you on a regular basis to pay for these relics, as Danilo put it, that are just keeping your children back. They really do. You know, that was something else he said, Danilo, that they stifle creativity. Well, and that's, I think, the most damaging thing about public schools is they suck the life out of children. And like I said earlier, the ones that succeed in the public schools come out with this false sense of security, like they have some knowledge and they have a head up on their classmates because that's what's pumped into them. And yes, will it translate later in life? If you're lucky, yeah, you'll get connected because you followed the rules and you played the game. But that's not really living. You know, the goal in life is to live it. So let your children do that, you know, especially if you were forced into that situation, that should give you all the more reason to not make your children go down the same path. You know, people always talk about, you know, getting that good job and succeeding in life so they can give their children the things they didn't have, but they never think of the things that they did have that they shouldn't have. And public schooling is one of those. You know, if you have the opportunity to give your child the freedom to learn at their own pace, you know, what they want to learn, what they're passionate about, you are giving them a gift that, you know, few of us were ever even given the opportunity to receive. And that's something amazing to me. And I can't wait to be able to do that for my kids. And I just really hope that other people, you know, follow that lead, because that's, that's the one thing I see is leading to a better world, is, you know, letting the kids learn on their own and letting them gain real knowledge, and then turning around and looking at the system and saying, yeah, we don't need you for this anymore. What else don't we need you for?
It absolutely starts at home with peaceful parenting and unschooling, and I am a firm believer of that. Unlike Stefan Molyneux, for example, Stefan thinks that peaceful parenting is the end all, that's going to bring about the end of the state in 200 years when everybody's become a peaceful parent. I can't say it's the only thing like that, but yeah, it is really important, and it is absolutely necessary to raise free thinking kids who are not a bunch of mindless robots who can churn out standardized testing.
I'll just mention a couple of logical fallacies. Amazing, we didn't even touch on a logical fallacy all episode. But so government schools are, in my mind, the appeal to authority, the appeal to antiquity, and the false dilemma. Right, so appeal to antiquity. You know, we've always had public school. How can you not send your kids to public school? I went to public school. Your grandfather went to public school. Why wouldn't you send your kids to public school? Look at you. You went to public school. You turned out okay.
That's the funny thing, is public schools have only been around for 100 years. That's it. 100 years is not a long time. I mean, how did people learn how to read in the 1300s or 1800s without shoving it down their throat? The answer is they didn't, because they didn't need to. They worked on farms. They don't need to learn how to read. They need to learn how to pull tractors and milk cows and shit like that. They don't need to learn.
You mean to tell me that William Shakespeare didn't go to public school? You're telling me that right now?
Probably not.
No, he didn't. I'm letting you know he did.
So you have the appeal to authority, right? You know, all the kids look to the teacher, the authority figure, as the conveyor of truth, right? Conveyor of knowledge, not to yourself, not to your peers, not like think about the answer. No, the teacher, it's a top down approach, right? And then the false dilemma, which would be, if we don't have government schools, we will be suffering from an epidemic of illiteracy, right? We will all be stupid, deaf, dumb, and blind, right? So, yeah, this is a very, very interesting topic that I think a lot of people need to consider, because I think the one thing that I like to think of as peaceful parents and as raising unschoolers is that we are breaking the cycle of violence, right? And this is what voluntarists basically advocate, is that, you know, if you this is another thing I ask people, you know, when I'm talking about unschooling and homeschooling, I say, did you enjoy your public schooling experience? Okay, and if they say no, then I'm like, well, how can you, in your right mind and with empathy and compassion, send your little ones to public school, to an institution that you suffered in and that you did not enjoy and you don't have happy memories from? How can you possibly do that? And does that not make you a sadist? Sick. It seems to me to be sick and twisted to do that. It's like, it's kind of like people who say, you know, I'm circumcised, so I got to circumcise my son. He's got to be exactly like me. You know, I'm amputated, I'm going to amputate my son. I have one eye. My son, you know, he has to be my carbon copy.
It pulls into the whole daddy will fix it scenario.
Yeah.
Daddy being government.
Yeah.
I don't want to raise my kids. I'll let government do it. That's essentially what you're saying when you send your kids to public school.
Yeah, that's the other thing I say is you know, if you give your children over to the state to raise them, don't be disappointed at the results, because you have no control over that anymore. I mean, not that you're trying to control your kids, but you are sending them to an institution where, actually, another thing we should probably mention is that when the CPS, Child Protective Services, picks up children, where do you think the place that they go to interview and to isolate and to get crucial information on the children is? In government schools, because they are separated from their parents, right? That is the only place that they go. That is the easiest place they can go to isolate them and get them to incriminate themselves, right, against their parents. So it's really sad and destructive. And I would even consider child abuse to send for people to send their kids to government schools. So we really have to. People should learn about history and learn about the history of government schools and what is how it's corrupting the youth, as we were talking about earlier. That is the true corrupting of the youth right there.
for sure. So thank you very much,
Jon, for coming on the show.
Yeah, guys, thanks for having me. If I can take a minute to just plug a few things and get a laugh. Go ahead.
Plug away, sir.
you can find me at the New Sons and Daughters of Liberty. That's my page for anything you want to bitch about the state, anything related to volunteerism, anarchy. That's where it's at right there. Any questions about unschooling? I really do believe in unschooling. But don't take it from me. Don't unschool your kids just because some crazy anti-statist on the internet told you to do it. Do your own research. Read the book. There's books by John Holt. There's Facebook groups. There's, you know, connect with people on Twitter. Do your own research and talk to people and learn as much as you can about unschooling.
Yeah, exactly. Educate yourselves, people. In the age of information, ignorance is a choice. Remember that, everybody. There's no excuses anymore.
You can talk to me about unschooling over at the Raising Common Sense Anarchist. We have about seven, eight, or nine admins, and they're all fantastic, and they all range in expertise from new unschoolers to experienced unschoolers. And we can absolutely answer any question that you might have about unschooling.
Awesome. Excellent resource.
Well, thank you, Jon, for coming on. I love you, brother.
Yeah.
I hope we can have you on in a future episode to maybe talk about something else. Maybe if you feel passionate about coming on and talking about something, I'm sure we'd love to have you again.
Yeah, sure. Hit me up on Facebook.
Definitely. Awesome. All right, so that wraps it up for another episode of the Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 9. Thank you very much for listening, and have a wonderful day.
We got to get something out of Jeremy. He hasn't talked in like 20 minutes. Come on, say something before we end the show.
My hat tip to the Freedom Fiends tonight. Worms.
Worms? All right.
I still don't get it, but okay. Do you get the relevance of that?
No. Thanks, everyone, for watching or listening.
There is a relevance. It's a takeoff on the old school, like in the 80s, 90s, when people used to say word. So they change it to worms instead to make it more their style, and it's something they do.
Nice. All right, we learned a little bit of trivia. Awesome. Thank you very much for listening, everyone. Have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace.
Bye. Bye.